Hello, welcome to the Checkpoint this year. And you are very welcome in this new year for the Checkpoint because we bring you insights, analysis, guidance on a number of current affairs topics that could be trending for certain reasons and bring you in-depth analysis of what happens wherever you're not. This week or today, we are going to be talking about the economy. And we have Professor Augustus Nwagaba, an international consultant on economic transformation and a wealth creation expert on monetary policy application. He has lots of experience in analyzing fiscal metrics for various governments in Africa. So he's going to be telling us what the recent developments in our economic sector mean for us and the current economic state of our country. What does it mean for the year? You're welcome, Professor.
Yeah, thank you very much, Urban Television.
Yes. See, Professor, some of the most recent developments that we are going to be hosting, the NAM Summit, the Non-Aligned Movement Summit, and the G77 plus China Summit. We just had the CISPOC summit happen for the speakers of Commonwealth. And all these summits are happening with the advocates saying that we get business, we get deals, we get to woo investors to come here and invest in our economy. As our economy, do you know of any deals or investors that have come in through this way? And also, how much do we gain from these summits?
Yeah, thank you very much, Vivian, and viewers of Urban Television. Of course, the summits, the purpose of the summits, like the ones we are going to have, and the ones we have had before, you know, we have had CHOGAM as well, the Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting, which took place here in 2007, and I'm glad I'm the one who represented you guys and Ugandans to summarize Uganda's performance for the years that the Commonwealth countries had been in the Commonwealth. Then now we have the NAM summit. And NAM, for purposes of our understanding of our viewers, this is a non-aligned movement. It was created in 1961 in Belgrade, Yugoslavia. And the purpose of this meeting, the purpose of this dispensation, the purpose of this was to make sure that countries keep away, you see, from the fights of the bipolar powers. At that time, it was, of course, US and Soviet Union. So it was thought that it would be good for these countries not to get entangled in these fights. They remain non-aligned. The non-aligned means in its literal meaning in the English language, you are not appended to. And so this is very important, Vivian, because you can easily get drowned into either United States of America or Soviet Union. These are nuclear powers. And if you're not careful, you have seen the wars, you've seen the civil conflicts, you saw the coup that took place, in earlier 1980s, 70s. In 1990s, there were a few. 2000, we have not seen many. And now they have come back.
Yes, so in West Africa especially.
In West Africa, in Niger, in Gundi. So the non-aligned movement is very important. It is an outfit that keeps those countries, there are 120 of them, to keep away from the entanglements, from the fights of these superpowers. And then number two, you have now the G77 plus China also meeting, which is going to be part of this. And by the way, the G77 plus China meeting is apart from United Nations General Assembly, which is 192 countries and above. The G77 is the second largest meeting in the world. It is the second largest entity again in the world, apart from United Nations. The countries which form the G77 plus China, And of course, we have to say plus China. Why? Because China does not accept, it doesn't want to have a status there. Its status is broad. It supports the G77, but it is not part of the G77. Even in the NAM, China is not a member of NAM. Neither is it saying, it is saying I'm aligned. It is not saying I'm not aligned. It's just an observer. It has an observer status. So people need to understand that. So China has an observer status in NAM. And in the G77 plus China, it has neither an observer status nor a membership status. It's just there, but supporting the cause for G77. So the benefits that we get, I think our viewers have now understood the meetings that we are going to have. We are going to have the non-aligned movement, which is opening on the 15th, and it's composed of 120 countries. And these countries are the ones who do not want to get entangled in the fights. I think now everybody is clear on that. And these countries are led by, were formed, by the way, by India, by Kwame Nkrumah in Ghana, by the people in Yugoslavia, and of course the first meeting was there in Belgrade. And so this is very good that movement was formed. And then we have the G77, which basically for it, it is different from NAM in one respect. Even its theme in Munyonyi is going to be leaving no one behind. For it is largely economic. I want to be very clear on this. The G77 plus China is largely economic, and it is no accident that therefore China is an interested party. Everybody knows that. China attracts about 48% of the global GDP, global foreign direct investment. Everybody who has money, and you need to invest your money. Every 48 out of 100, every 5 out of 10 wants to take that money to China. And so China is definitely, automatically, very, very interested, although it's not a member. So its aim and its theme for this year is a very simple theme, leaving no one behind, and it is basically an economic front. It is just countries on economic front. They want to harness economic cooperation. They want to harness the partaking of world markets. They want to harness participation in economic benefits of those countries. Now, NAM is a little bit different. For it, its current theme is of course, deepening cooperation for sharing affluence, the global affluence. It means, I think people are following, if you are following, it means, it just means these 120 countries need to share what we call the global, if you want, the global opportunities, not necessarily economic, but also political, the human rights, observers, welfare of the people, benefits that are both economic and social, and so on. So NAM, if you want, has more broader interests than G77 plus China, whose main objective is really to ensure that you deepen economic benefits that accrue from this G77 plus China, especially plus that China, as everybody knows.
Professor, you have ably explained to us what these mean, but do you know of any deals? Do you know of any investments in Uganda that came through because, say, we had CHOGAM in the past, or just the recently concluded CISPOC summit? Do you know of any deals that were signed and Uganda will be benefiting as an economy?
Yeah, thank you very much, Vivian. You know, you know, when you get a visitor, yourself, if you leave yourself, you want to get a visitor at home, say you're home, you want to receive visitors, your sister is going to get married. Do you know the first thing you do at home, making the home beautiful, isn't it? Buy extra glasses. You buy extra plates if you didn't have nice ones, because you are going to receive special visitors. The first benefit from this meeting, don't even go far, is uplift of our infrastructure. You have been seeing Kampala infrastructure. They have been having here a display of potty holes. You know, they used the other cartoonist called it what?
The Pothole City.
The Pothole City. And this has been worked on. You may say it has not been worked on well, but that is the first direct benefit of everybody, if you wanted to categorize them. So what are the direct benefits of every Ugandan? Is that you need a little bit of uplift of infrastructure. Like Chogam, we had very serious uplift of infrastructure around that Naira Avenue. Even now I pass Naira Avenue. It is again the place where they are uplifting the infrastructure. That the beauty that you have in the city. They are working on the roads. And it would have been good because we knew this meeting. We didn't know that this meeting was going to take place yesterday. We knew it about 3 years ago. But of course, because of so many other commitments of government, of course, maybe government was not able to raise the money quickly. But if it had raised the money quickly, then we would have had good uplift of infrastructure, of roads, of planting of these flowers. And you saw how Chogam planted flowers up to Entebbe, uplifting of the Entebbe airport to be able to receive also a little bit of a number of visitors. So every Ugandan, every Kampalan should be able to benefit from that. And then two is that, Vivian, without being overly pedantic, is that you as a country, you know, as a country, you know, our country, the word Uganda has been on international media for the last, I think for the last like 90 days, everywhere you open. Even in social media, whatever media outlet you open, of course the word is Uganda to host the parliamentary Commonwealth Parliamentary Conference. Mm-hmm. We are going to host NAM. We are going to host G77 plus China. So that alone also posits what you call international visibility. I was in London the other day before you guys contracted the Chogam here. I was going to contract it actually I was in London around 2019 there. I had a very simple task. It was for United Nations and I was mapping. UN told me to map Ugandans in the diaspora, how much money they bring here in Uganda every year. So I was everywhere. I was in London, I was in Edinburgh, I was in Manchester, I held very meetings in Leeds, in
so
Dubai.
International so international consultants, so, like you get business.
Now that was coming. Hmm. I was able to map $1.7 billion of the money which Ugandans bring here. This is the same money which tourism brings. Tourism brings $1.6 billion. But our sisters, these girls you see going to Abu Dhabi, to Qatar, to Oman, do you know the amount of money they bring here? $900 million. Then we have our doctors, engineers in Detroit, in Canada, in Montreal, in Boston. These bring also $700 million. So 700 plus 900, that's 1.6. Plus the one of tourism, that's about 3.3 billion over 45.7 billion, they bring about 10.2% GDP. So how do we, so when I heard the meeting in Manchester, I heard the meeting in London, and the purpose of that meeting was to ask them, when they bring their money, where do they invest? And the answer is that, first of all, they didn't know where to invest. They didn't know how to bring that money. So the purposes of these meetings, Vivian, is to, first of all, to create that leverage, it is to create that visibility, so that people know that Uganda is here. It can, if Uganda can host 120 heads of state of NAM. By the way, we are only talking about heads of state. We have other 10 observers states. We have other 17. So 10 plus 17 plus 120, 137. Like all agencies, almost at the level of a country who are going to be here in Munyonyo. That's not a simple feat. So what does that mean? It causes attraction of foreign direct investment. You know, what do we mean by foreign direct investment? These are people who have money and they are failing to know where to put it. Not because they hate Uganda, but nobody has brought Uganda on the table and made them attracted to bring their money there. So purposes of these meetings is to ensure that even if for you, you have not been able to supply your linen on the tables where they're going to sit, but there's someone out there who is going to be, to look at it. Come on, look here. Uganda can host 120 heads of state and government. This is the country where to invest. And in that case, you can increase your foreign direct investment. To cut the story short, actually, Uganda's foreign direct investment has increased from zero. From zero, Vivian, and there were urban television viewers in 1986, 3.6% of GDP. Our GDP is $45.6 billion. So get 3.6 over 100 times 45.6%. Those who went to school, you cannot deny the amount of money that we have improved as a result of attracting people to bring their money here. And these are the things which attract them. Then, of course, the last one, which is very clear, is that when these visitors come, then, of course, Uganda's image is improved on the global stage. I was in Geneva the other day. We have a small consulate there. It's not yet an embassy. And when I was trying to get lunch, get a meal somewhere in Geneva, the only thing I could get is a pizza, you cannot get, then when I said, you can't get matoke, you can't get a banana. When they brought me a banana, exactly as a dessert, they brought me these high starch content bananas from Jamaica. Then when I asked, don't you know there are bananas from, for example, Isinjiro in Uganda from Bushenyi, which are the best in the world? I was very clear on this one, because we had in our embassy, our consulate, head of consul in Geneva was a friend of mine. Said, where is this? You do know what he told me? First of all, no guarantee. No one knows about our bananas. Our bananas don't have a guarantee in Brussels and also in WTO, so they cannot access that market. But they said, how? These ones are from Jamaica. Why? They know Usain Bolt, they know Justine. These are the people who are on the television and in Olympics. On these Arsenal Man TVs, which you see people going to see everywhere. These are things which matter, in case Ugandans didn't know. And so unless you have this meeting, Uganda is also on this world TV screens. Your products are very difficult to access these global markets.
Well, recently, the United States of America removed us from the AGOA trade deal. And end of this AGOA trade deal for Ugandans means loss of a huge market, and some may even argue that there's product credibility given that the US is an influential powerhouse. Mm. And it had been reported that we were making about 4 billion Ugandan shillings from this export revenue that was happening within this deal. 40 billion Uganda shillings. Professor, what implications does the loss of this export revenue bring into our country, and what gaps will Uganda experience as a result of being removed from the AGOA deal?
Yeah, that word AGOA, people need to understand these things properly. What is AGOA? AGOA was the African Growth Opportunity Act of May 2000.
Yes.
Now, remember President Bill Clinton was here earlier and negotiated this opportunity. So the AGOA, therefore, Act gave Uganda access of duty-free products. Mm. Very, very important, duty-free products to American markets. What does this mean? This meant that you export towards vegetables, a little bit of cereals, legumes, I remember
textiles, fish,
then apparel textiles. These would now access American markets without NTBs, these non-tariff barriers. You would access those markets without any, in international trade, we have what we call rules of origin. We have guarantees. Actually, that was a very, very serious guarantee. A guarantee in international market is where your product can access me without much hassling, without much hassle. You just bring your product. It is guaranteed. It has been approved. It is good. Bring it. We like it. This is what they told us. And it was a very, very big opportunity for this process. Another one was EBA, Everything But Arms, which was meat, especially for goat meat in the Uganda Arab Emirates, and also to European Union markets. We were allowed to export there everything except, of course, arms. That was EBA. So EBA and AGOA, these were very, very important instruments that were supposed to help us to balance our balance of payments. When our exports increase, then we earn more than when we export. Currently, the way the Ugandan export structure is that we are spending too much on the things we are importing, earning less on things we are exporting. If we go to real economics.
Because of value addition, Professor.
Yes,
isn't
because
that
of
so?
Lack of, yeah, because of lack of, you are just exporting coffee. Isn't it?
Yes.
The coffee value chain is $190 billion. $190 billion. The entire coffee value chain globally, of which Uganda is a third
in the world.
Yeah, third highest producer of the highest quality coffee and the eighth in volume. Mm. Of course, some of this volume is also stolen from us. So we export the third highest quality and also the eighth highest in volume, but we don't even earn 1% of the entire global value chain product of $190 billion, because we are earning less than $600 million. It's not even a billion. If it was 1.9 billion, that's where when we would earn 1%. But we are not earning even 1 billion. So we are earning less than 1% of the entire global value chain. Why? Because of one single factor, which is lack of agro processing, lack of value addition.
And the president has been very strong on value addition.
So when AGOA came in May 2000, the understanding was, let Uganda also access American market. Why is it important to access American market? Of course, American market is the largest. America is the largest economy in the world. Mm. Its GDP is $24.2 trillion, not billion. Let me repeat it, $24.2 trillion, followed by China, $17.7 trillion. Then you bring Japan, then you bring Germany. Germany is the fourth. Japan is the third. Then Turkey, London, UK, India, and others. Others come in like that. So this was a golden opportunity to ensure that Uganda can access the world's largest economy. This is not something simple. Because remember, those markets have a lot of, I've already told you, they have a lot of what in Uganda they call bukwakulizo. Mm. They have a lot of rules and regulations for your product to enter. So it's not easy. So it was very good to enter. Now we have said Uganda is out. It's not the only one. Also Niger is out. Gabon is out. Central African Republic is out. We are four countries which have been struck off.
You know why I'm laughing, Professor?
Yes.
The countries in which category we've been grouped are countries that have had coups lately. They like the previous 1 year, they are countries that had.
Yeah, you have Niger, you coups. Have Central African Republic,
Gabon.
You have Gabon, and then Uganda. Four.
Yes.
Of these countries have been struck off. And the reasons are simple, because for them they are looking at a number of things. Your country must move very well on human rights, it must move. Or you are highly democratic, or they say in their words, we are moving towards having democracy, human rights, observance of all those things. Mm. And when they say human rights, I'm sure for Uganda, that's where we have had trouble with them. When they say human rights, their composition, their understanding of human rights, it may not be the objective understanding of human rights, which we all know. And I don't want to go into that detail.
But
at this stage,
shall we recover from the loss of this market?
Now, the total export under AGOA initiative is approximately 40 billion Uganda shillings. It's not 40 billion dollars.
Yes.
40 billion Uganda shillings. This is not an extremely large, I don't think, let me be technical a bit. I don't think that it has capacity to create a knock-on effect, what we call a knock-on effect in economic modeling. A knock-on effect in economic modeling means, like a bank, you close a bank, which is, there are like banks, which we call too big to fall. You know, when a bank is too big to fall, you see? A bank like JP Morgan in the US economy, there is no way like American government can allow JP Morgan to fall, because it's too big to fall. It is the mother of the entire banking sector. So I don't think that AGOA really is a mother here of. I don't think in any form that's it. But it is good. It's a good market. But let me tell Ugandans, when we say these markets, when you say market, let me use a very simple example. When you say common market for East Africa, do you know this common market and East African community? What do we mean? There is no way. It is in any way, nowhere near to being your uncle or your aunt. We are not talking about your uncle. We are not talking about your aunt. We are talking about what? A market. A market means competition. This is what markets are. We have perfect markets. We have imperfect markets. But the market like AGOA is a market which was provided to us. It's not a perfect market. Why? Because it was a market which was provided to us under certain circumstances, under a trade agreement, and therefore this is not a perfect market. A perfect market is where your products come, they're in a market, everybody's there, you are competing, and your market must have highest quality standard. This is what I want to bring out here. So what I want to tell Ugandans is that when we talk about the market, we're not talking really about your uncles or aunties. We're talking about bringing in the market products that of high quality. In Rutshigari Nyankore, let me use Rutshigari Nyankore. We have what you call ebiyaje. Ebiyaje is mandazi in Uganda, is fried cakes, which in our language are usually done so well that even the aroma that is coming from the person who you are following and saying doesn't need to say anything about now the
you will want the to
exactly
buy them.
Everybody wants to buy it. So why can't we make our products and everybody wants to buy them by the highest quality standards, and you don't need to beg? Why do we need to beg for people to buy our coffee? It is the best coffee. Why do we need to beg for people to come and see our mountain gorillas? Uganda is the only country in the world with mountain gorillas. Why do you need to you look at our fish, flowers? What I want to tell Ugandans is that when it comes to market, the way I understand it, the way I studied it, I'm a businessman, the way I sell my products in markets, is that I must have highest quality standard. That's what I want. You look at our maize. Recently, what happened in
See, let me just bring out the East African community market, because we have had challenges there. The leaders in the other countries took some decisions that could have hurt our business with them, because in Kenya, there was a ban on our milk and grain products.
In South
Sudan, we also had an issue with our maize. Are we getting boxed in?
The issue, let me tell Vivi and our viewers, the issue, of course, like let's begin with Kenya. Kenya, that was outside our control. That was not even economics. It wasn't.
It was politics?
Yeah, it was just politics. And some other reasons. Just politics. The Kenya-Uganda quarrel over milk was nowhere near economics. People should not confuse issues. And we understand it fully. So that was something else. Let's talk about the South Sudan maize. The South Sudan maize was purely economics. Why? Because this is a market. And when you say common market of East Africa, we mean, please, bring your product which is of high quality, standard. So the South Sudan said our maize has aflatoxins. And you know, this thing of aflatoxins had also been raised also with Kenya, and Kenya went to Malawi. And can you imagine Kenya leaving Uganda and maize and going to Malawi to buy maize. Malawi has one season of maize.
Mm.
Here we have two. Maybe the two seasons is because we have two rains that one is bringing us problems, especially when it comes to drying the maize. So our maize was found to have higher levels of aflatoxins than Malawi and Kenya. Can you imagine such an irony?
Mm.
What kind of paradox is that? Kenya buying maize from Malawi in preference to Uganda's maize. Then I told
accepting
the Ugandans.
To incur transport
I told
charge.
The Ugandans exactly. Mm. You look, what transport charge is Kenya going to spend on importing maize from Malawi relative to Uganda?
Mm-hmm.
Then I told them these markets are not your uncles. That's why I got that word. You remember these are not aunties. These are not relatives. This is a market. Please work on your standards. And I think everybody has understood.
Yes.
That's why I want to commend at this juncture, I want to commend our the chairman LC5 of HOIMA. You know, the chairman LC5 of HOIMA and the entire council of HOIMA passed ordinances at sub-county levels and bylaws and ordinances at sub-county and district for drying coffee very well. They cannot allow people to spoil markets of others by harvesting green berries, which will spoil the market for coffee, and then other people lose. So I want at this stage to salute Pippin Hoima for that. I wish every Ugandan was doing that to ensure that now you can improve your quality. But don't start quarreling when people are requiring you to have standards. Sudan was that. Kenya, something else, a little bit, but also on coffee, also on maize in Kenya, it was also aflatoxins. Maize in Sudan, aflatoxins. Now, milk, I've already told you something different, but let's work on the point is, what I want Ugandans to understand. Let's work on our standards and be like the Ruchiga, Runyankore. For us, the way we make our products, and we call it, let me use our Ruchiga Runyankore proverb. Aketunda, akarunjike etunda, meaning something of high quality standards that doesn't need advertising. People should be able to come and buy. Let's make our products akarunjike etunda, meaning our products for Ugandan products should be self-advertising.
So well, Professor, we have a problem with our milk consumption. Milk? That is for sure. Milk consumption. Mm. It is low locally. Mm. And yet we want to build local consumption so that our market too, locally, is able to ensure business for those who produce. Mm. Because now we are having problems with our neighbors and the government has promised and has been talking about getting us new markets for Ugandan products. Do we have leads when it comes to other markets? And how do we also build markets within our economy?
Yes, you see the problem with milk, for example, is that we produce too much milk, especially in raw, R-A-W. In a raw form. Now, this Vivian bring maize is the same thing. Bananas, I'm a banana grower of large scale. I'm a large scale one. I'm also having the same problem. Because when you produce banana, or everybody produces banana in Bushenyi, in Mbarara, in Uganda, everywhere bananas. In Mbali, everywhere bananas. Maize. So when you talk of local market, I agree with you. We need the local market. To ensure that our children, first of all, get good nutrition, our schools, institutions get enough food, but you need to do two things, to have agriculture for home consumption, for food security, but also for commercial. That's why we have parish development model.
Mm.
The parish development model and all these models we have had before are for doing one thing, Vivian, if Ugandans don't know, is for monetizing the rural economy, making sure that we produce food, not for home consumption only, but leaving some, a very big proportion actually, for commerce, for commercial, so that people can pay school fees with their children, you can be able to go to the hospital, you can be able to buy a car as well by selling your maize, if you which you had at a large scale. But now, if you have maize, I have maize now, everybody has maize, who is going to buy your maize at a higher price? In fact, I'm worried. Vivian, I was in Kamwenge about 2 months ago with one of our projects. And Kamwenge, we are going to get maize this year. I don't know how much is going to be the price. Government needs to look into this, see what it's going to do to ensure the price of maize is going to be stabilized so that farmers don't find themselves having too much low price and getting demotivated. So you need agro-processing. You need adding value to maize, to milk, to flowers, to
meat.
Vegetables, meat products. Why? To extend their shelf life and also extend market, because there's no way you can sell maize under EBA, I told you, to United Arab Emirates, to European Union, when the maize, the flowers, the vegetables, the meat cannot be preserved. So we need to work on that. And once you do that, then currently we have total imports, as I told you. Our total imports is about 1.6. Total exports, about $1.6 billion. Total imports, 5-point-something billion dollars. So the balance of trade, you know, the balance of trade is something simple which every Ugandan must know. The balance of trade is something simple. It is the amount of money we spend on the things we have imported.
Exports.
As exactly, as related to the amount of money we have spent on the things we have bought from abroad. Currently, it is negative $4.3 billion. So we spend net, the net effect of X minus M, of the amount of money spent minus amount of money, and we are in negative. We spend more $4.3 billion per year than exactly the money we have earned. Which is what does this mean in the English language? Let's leave finance and economics. In the English language, it means you have donated jobs from those countries where you have spent the other negative $4.3 billion. You have purely provided jobs for those people. Why and how? Because you have given them money. You have given them things for their people to do.
Which we want for our economy.
Exactly. And so we should stop that. How do you stop it? Add value to coffee, to our maize, to beef, to milk. That's why now they talk of the diversification of markets. Because we have had problems with Kenya, which I don't want to go into detail, we shall take another 4 hours, but we all know. Why do you have only Kenya as our market for milk? That's why now the president went to Algeria. The Democratic People's Republic of Algeria, the ambassador is here, is a friend of mine. We have discussed with them. They are willing to buy our processed milk. And now, if Kenya hears that, now we have an alternative market. Do you know they will start saying, okay, let's come and negotiate. That's how you increase your voice in the market. You increase your leverage in terms of the market outlets. And then you now despair these monopsonies, where people think that they are the only buyers. You know, monopsony is very, very terrible. Where somebody thinks he's the only buyer of your product, this is very, very dangerous. Let's stop monopsonies, let's diversify markets, and then you are going to have your farmers earning more benefits from these products.
Professor, I cannot close this show without asking you about our debt. So let's talk about Uganda's debts. Our debt, as of August last year, stood at 88 trillion shillings. And we are now told that in the next financial year, about 23 trillion shillings will be dedicated to repayment of that debt. Is government waking up to tame its borrowing appetite?
Our debt to GDP ratio.
Yes.
The one we use, you calculate the amount of debt that you have, divide by the Obugagabugo, let me speak in Uganda. Obugagabugo, I've told you it is 45.67 billion dollars. Our debt is 50.2% of our GDP. So you get 50.2 divided by 100 times 45.6. That's the amount of debt, which is approximately 23.1%. So the 23.1 billion. That debt is divided into two categories. You need to know that we have debt, which is in United States dollars, exactly.
Yes, domestic or and also
debt which is in hard currency, either in euros, in pound sterling, in United States dollars, and other hard currencies. Total of that is the one which is large, forms about 63% of the entire debt. Then the 37, let's be very technical now, of the 37% of the other 50.2%, the 37% of the 50.2% is the debt which the government owes to us as individuals. You have heard about treasury bills,
yes,
and bonds. These are people now who have treasury bills and bonds. And that is about 37% of the entire debt. So the 37% of the 88 you are talking about. Now, there are three things which are required in what you call debt sustainability analysis. Debt sustainability analysis means you look at yourself, even you at home when you reach home. You, me, everybody, when you reach home. Is there anybody who doesn't have debt?
None of us. We
put up your hand, in Uganda, and I'm talking to, put up your hand if you don't have a debt. We shall sing for you. To God be the glory. We shall really sing for you. So everybody has debt. The difference is three things. One, why did you contract debt? Was it necessary? In Uganda's case, surely Vivian, the answer is yes. Why did we contract this debt?
Infrastructure.
Exactly, we need Karuma Dam. This $1.7 billion. Actually, it has gone now, plus transmission of that line. It is going towards $2.2 billion. We have Simba Dam, Ayago. We have roads, all these roads. For me now, I drive up to my bedroom in Kabale. Just a distance of 417 kilometers. I'm on the tarmac up to my bedroom. Even the people who continue to Kisoro, up to Arua. Moroto, Nakapiripirit Road through Queen is tarmac. Moroto, Kataku Kumi is tarmac.
And we still have issues of that infrastructure. For example, on Mitiana Road through Mubende.
Of course, they're
headed to that side. So not all our roads are actually
exactly
well.
Vivian and our viewers,
condition.
Now, at your home, do you eat chicken every day? At your home, do you prepare for your dinner and the children chicken every day?
No,
answer is no.
Mm.
Don't you want to have chicken and meat and fish every day?
Mm.
Answer is yes. Are you able, professor? Can you prepare chicken at home every day? No. Don't you have your children to eat chicken, meat? No, I would want. Are you able? No, because there are other priorities. So the government also works like that. Don't you want to try the Mercedes Benz? Yes. So please differentiate wants and needs. The famous English adage, if every wish, we are horses, then beggars would ride. If every wish, we are horses, beggars would ride. So the fact that too many things, you need only to know what do you want to use this debt for. So ours has not been very bad. What has really has been infrastructure, especially energy and roads. Question two, where did you get this money from? It's a very, very important question. This 88 trillion, that 88 trillion is both. Even the other dollars, we translated it in shillings as well. So it is a total, the other 88. Where did we get it from? Very important. Remember, the first one was, why did you want it? We have explained that. Two now, where did you get it from? So we get the money from different sources. That's what I want to tell Ugandans. Even you, me, we get debts, but where did you get money from? Money lenders, or circles, or VSROs, or microfinance and deposit finance institutions, DFIs, MFIs, or Commercial Bank, or Uganda Development Bank, or East African Development Bank, or World Bank. Have you seen the order? Have you seen the order I've used?
Mm.
The order I've used, we refer to it in economics and finance as pecking order. Let me repeat it. It's called P-E-K-I-N-G order. This order is one which determines whether you're going to be rich or poor. Let me tell these friends of ours. Let me tell the Ugandans, when we borrow money, please make sure that you know the order in which you are getting this money, where and at what ladder is that source. In the seven sources I've explained, that order I've used from MoneyLend like that up to World Bank is also the level at which the interest is going to reduce. This level at which interest is going to reduce. So you start from up, World Bank, East African Development Bank, Uganda Development Bank, Commercial Bank, microfinance institutions, micro deposit taking institution, circles, MoneyLend is the way the interest is increasing. So how do you get money from MoneyLenders or Commercial Bank and you want plant coffee? What kind of stupidity is this? What kind of stupidity is this? And you want plant coffee telling me you got money from MoneyLenders? Please, please, please. You want plant coffee by getting money from MoneyLenders. You want to build an arcade, a shopping arcade, using money from a Commercial Bank. We don't get money for building arcades from commercial banks. This is a long-term investment. So you cannot get money from a short-term source. Getting money from a short-term source for a long-term investment is a financial irony. It's a paradox you cannot solve. That's why your arcade is going to be sold.
And Professor, we have those issues in our economy, but also repayments of those debts has been an issue. In fact, 20 countries in Africa have been defaulting on repayment of their debt. And as we close, how are we repaying our debt? Also, what sectors do you think or hope that in this year will be leading and will help grow our economy this year?
Debt repayment, I agree with you, is the third question.
Mm.
Remember the first one, why did you need money? Two, I've explained it very well. Where did you get the money? Now, the last one is, do you have ability, Vivian,
to pay
back this money? Do you have ability, Uganda government, to pay back the money you are borrowing?
And more than 50% of our budget is being spent on paying back
servicing. I agree with you. Which
is that healthy?
Which means, the do you know the 30% of the money we are going to get, total budget of the 52.7 trillion is for debt repayment, which means almost half of the money we get from URA is for repaying debt. Now, in economic management, the way I know it, maybe let me say the little I know about economic management globally, is that there are two priorities which you must, if you are indented, if you are highly leveraged. The first thing, the moment we get money from URA, the first thing is debt, what? Repayment before you do anything else. Even before you buy medicine. Even before you pay doctors, nurses, frontline people. You must repay debt. You don't want to default, Vivian. This is the last thing any government wants. Failure to meet your debt obligation. Then number two, payment of salaries, of course. Then three, others. That's how a country is run. That's how an economy is run. That's how a Minister of Finance is run. So number one, scale of preference. Repayment of debt, I agree with you. We have trouble because most of the money is being on debt repayment. But what do we do? That's why the government has to continue borrowing. Borrowing and every Wednesday, there are treasury bills auction. So the Bank of Uganda will come, say we have treasury bills and bonds. So you have to go there and buy. That's now domestic debt for now paying this and so on. And do you know what this creates? Once government now borrows, people need to understand this as well. And also Professor and Vivian also coming to also borrow.
Mm.
We are all borrowing from the same source. which is a commercial bank. And then the commercial bank would realize government is borrowing also, but also individuals are borrowing. Individuals for us, me and you, are usually high risk sources. So the commercial bank is giving it stand big, it is going to say, whom do I lend? Hmm. Do I lend the government or I lend individuals? The banks will lend to government as a preference to individuals.
For it's simple a reason, borrower.
Yeah, for simple reason, because you are more risky. And do you know what that causes? Now in the debt sustainability analysis and management is that interest rate raises. Why? Because the money, which is literal now, has got more competition. When any commodity in the market, people are six people, they want two loaves of bread. But people who want bread are six. The price of the other two loaves of bread will increase. It's very, very simple economics. You don't need to go to any economics class. It will rise. So the same thing, when we go to these banks, why is interest rate high? And Uganda has one of the highest interest rates in the world. Is it because of that? Because
Professor, let's wrap up. Governments are borrowing, you are borrowing, I'm borrowing,
everybody's borrowing, money becomes highly costly.
Let's wrap this up. Mm. Just in a few sentences, what are those sectors this year that you're hoping will do well in terms of economic growth?
Tourism sector. I was in Kabarin on Christmas, and the tourism sector has rebounded. I was so happy. So many tourists have come. So I'm expecting the $1.7 billion tourism to rise towards possibly $2.2 billion, $2.4 there. That's one of the sectors that we need to really have commitment on, invest in, have good infrastructure. Like for us, if that Kabare Bunyonyi Road was made and there is like a circuit around Lake Bunyonyi up to the Chanika, the other side, and then coming to the other side towards the mountain gorillas now. Why? Wow. Wow. I don't know how much money now we could attract. If we can attract this kind of $1.7 billion, of which mountain gorillas contribute less than, I mean, more than half of the entire quantum of this, and the sector would be revamped. Then two is the agriculture sector, which sustained us in COVID, as you know. And there were only two countries in the world, Uganda and China, whose economic growth remained positive. Uganda because of agriculture, China because of manufacturing. These were the only two countries out of 192. Agriculture should be able to do that. And then telecoms should continue. Why? Because also COVID has demonstrated the robustness of the communication subsector, the online conferences, online meetings, all of those tools, digital transformation we have had has been tremendous. So I'm expecting the telecommunications subsector to leverage on what already was achieved under COVID, and it should be able to do that. And then industry is currently contributing 27% to GDP, agriculture 23%, and of course the services sector is 42 to make 100. So our GDP is largely from telecoms and banks. I want Ugandans to know. Our GDP obugaga bugafe, kakati buva mubjama simugano, naza banka. It is from really two sectors, banks and telecoms. This is not good, Vivian. Why? Because these are not sectors which are employing Ugandans. The employment is still in agriculture and primary, other primary extracts. And also mining, especially gold, has increased, so we should concentrate again very seriously on tourism, agriculture, extractives, mining, and oil is coming as part of that subsector, and then we work very hard on ICT infrastructure. And if we have energy continuing to increase, then industry should come up automatically, the cost of electricity should come down, and then it attracts foreign and domestic direct investment.
Professor Augustus Nwagala, thank you very much for joining us on the show. He is an international consultant on economic transformation. This has been the week's checkpoints. Until next week, I am Vivian Kamsimi.